like the flesh. Glory to God. It is possible that you can have the flesh under subjection through Christ. So everything where you struggle with, if you give it over to Jesus, you know, him deal with it for you, you know. That it mean. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In other words, these people who have accepted God's rule, his subjects. Philippians 2 verse 8 says, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. The cross can be replaced with crucifixion. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Even the death of the cross or crucifixion. So crucifixion figuratively means to extinguish or to subdue the passions or selfishness. Right? What is his righteousness? His beliefs. His righteousness is his beliefs. His truth. That's what it is. So, one can only be righteous by faith, because his beliefs can only be from him through direct communication. So, it means, for you believe something what somebody say, you have to talk to them. That's why even criminals are tried in court. They get a chance to persuade the jury. Right? So if God don't get a chance to persuade us to become subdued to him or submissive, we can't believe him. We can't believe somebody whom we don't know. How can one be righteous if they don't communicate with God? An unseen God, a God that dwells in heaven as a spirit. It means You say, all right, the man who get the Goliath, I get a big lick, you know. David know Goliath big, but in the spirit, glory to God, David is a giant, and that's what God wants us to be.
Yes, Lord.
So David see Goliath, the physical, and then the Lord, glory to God, heard Goliath, Mandokoshaya, and the anointing that is smeared over him, Makoshaya, Nakusha, the anointing upon David, Mandokosha, glory, Hashokosaya, the anointing upon him, Makusha, David transformed. Goliath in the spirit, glory, hallelujah, meaning form, not in carnality, because God bigger than Goliath. So what David turned into, he put on a suit, you know. You know them iron suit there? Yeah. Armor. When the Bible talks about spiritual armor, you're a spiritual boy. You're a bright boy. You know, don't it? Yeah, man, Ephesians. That David put on physically, you know. So everybody cast all things. Yeah, so him a go beat and win Goliath and so on. So, but David say, but me never yet use them in my life. Aye. David has said, but this time I feel too hot. Because one time I want to run up and lick the boy, it go hold me down. So David said, here what? This too heavy, man. I can't mark who shy. So David just goes, so here what, Saul? I can't use it. You know what David said? And I look at such wisdom in David's response. David said, because I have never proven them. Glory. But who David prove? Who David prove? Glory to God. And this is telling us what should be happening now. A form of new wine is pouring out, saints. Let me just explain. Can I have a little bit of time? I'm so sorry if I'm going over. Just watch me and bear with me. And somebody just, time. Don't feel ashamed. Good. Yes. This is what is happening. Sometime, we think, say, boy, God, why you come true for me? And we go down in a some bad fasting, you know. That now, you know, a Saul armor that we are put on, you know. Because we think we can do it through works. You understand? We think, say, oh, much we suffer and we hungry, I got to work. And, you know, God no love you because you fast. Grace and mercy. He said to his mother, that my hour has not come for the new wine to be poured out. A revival is going on. The new wine is available, saints. I'm just telling you that shortly. And David drew for the new wine. Because nobody never knew about Holy Ghost them time there. You understand? David said, I never had proved them here, you know. And him take it off. Saul probably thinks he's mad. Saul gully turn him back and said, the boy, I got dead in him. I go and go see if I can eat some peanut and wine and something. And when David, it's the Bible say when Goliath, June, the Bible said David draw down upon the boy, you know. I want to understand how David a roll out. David now roll out like no soldier in the army. David roll out and him roll out with him roll out with no Jericho. I want sling, the Bible call it. You know what's a sling? His belief. Seek ye first. Seek ye first. Seek ye first. And the might that David pulled with. Probably when Goliath did them, go check if I read the stone where him threw. The might was the power of God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to God. Do you believe that God can do it for you? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, glory to God. So seek ye first, saints. And I don't think I have, because I write down a whole heap of sitting in, but I don't know if anything else important, because I don't want to be disobedient to the Lord. So let me just scroll through. Yes, so I got 3 points. Let me just quickly go over. So it's the kingdom without me. It's a seek ye first the kingdom without me, and my place in the kingdom. So I can do without you, you can do without me. All right? That's why even though David was the one who pulled the sling, Saul had an army. You understand? And we are the army that the Lord wants to rattle up in this end time. To take the things. God wants to restore us. You understand? God wants to clothe us with an anointing. Not a physical one. A spiritual one. Like what he gave to David. Because even at this time when you draw the sling, the loan come true for the car. Or the money come true for the car. I want everyone to understand me. In one, when you draw the sling, children, you get the 90 or 100 on your test. You understand? Believe God, and he will do it for you. Believe God, and he will do it for your saints. Thank you so much for your time.
Come on, continue with that worship. Glory to God. I will say Christianity boring. And who says serving God boring? Glory to God. You can add a little drama to it. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And the word of God make it just a smile. So, amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's get to it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This time we're going to have a song. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And praise team, get yourself ready. Hallelujah. Sister Gabrielle Smith. Come, sister, come sing to the glory of God. Praise team, get yourself ready. Hallelujah. When you walked among men, Lord Jesus, you know if you're looking below, it is worse now than then. All that screaming and shouting, all the violence and crying. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Just give me the strength to do everything that I have to do. But yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. So help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Lord, just give me the strength to do everything that I have to do. But yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. So help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. One day at a time. Hallelujah. Let us jump to our feet. It's praise and worship time. Come on, praise team.
Hallelujah. Let's jump to our feet. Hallelujah. Let me hear worship the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lift your hands and worship the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord today? Let me hear shout hallelujah. 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 Give the Lord your best praise this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. You are the Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning and you are the ending. You are the first and you are the last. Hallelujah. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. He's the great I am, the everlasting Father. He's the Prince of Peace, the great eternal wonder, Holy Counselor, and Zion's righteous. He's the great I am. Oh, he's the great I am. Everlasting Father, he's the Prince of Peace, the great eternal wonder, Holy Counselor, and Zion's righteous governor. He's the great I am. Oh, he's the great I am. The everlasting Father, he's the Prince of Peace, the great eternal wonder, Holy Counselor, and Zion's righteous governor. He's the great I am. How great is our God? How great is his name? He's the greatest one, forever the same. He roared back the water from the mighty Red Sea. He said, I lead you. Won't you trust in me? How great is our God? How great is his name? He's the greatest one, forever the same. He roared back the water from the mighty Red Sea. He said, I lead you. Won't you trust in me? How great is our God? How great is his name? He's the greatest one, forever the same. He roared back the waters from the mighty Red Sea. He said, I lead you. Won't you trust in me? Great is the Lord, great is the Lord. Hail him, shout his name afar. He is the light that shineth in the darkness. He is a bright and morning star. Great is the Lord, great is the Lord. Hail him, shout his name afar. He is the light that shineth in the darkness. He is a bright and morning star. Great is the Lord, great is the Lord. Hail him, shout his name afar. The light that shineth in the darkness. He is the bright and morning star. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. Hail him, shout his name afar. He is the light that shineth in the darkness. He is the bright and morning star. He is the light that shineth in the darkness. He is the bright and morning star. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's all worship the Lord. Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. We want to thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. We praise you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. You deserve all the glory, Jesus. We exalt you in this place. Hallelujah. 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 We lift you up, God. Hallelujah. You deserve all the glory. Hallelujah. We have nothing else to give, Lord, but our worship. We worship you this morning, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Great is your faithfulness, Jesus, towards us, God. And we thank you today, God. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Be the center, it's all about you. Yes, it's all about
Hallelujah. From my heart,
from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
Jesus at the center of it all.
Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to it's always in you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do.
Hallelujah.
And Jesus, you're the center, and everything revolves around you,
Jesus. You,
nothing else matters,
and nothing else
Jesus,
you're the center, and everything revolves around you,
Jesus, you.
From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center. All about you, yes, it's all about
from my heart, Lord Jesus,
from my heart
to the heavens,
Jesus be the center. It's all about you, yes, it's all about you,
Jesus,
hallelujah,
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus. Jesus.
We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Jesus. And Jesus. Jesus.
Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's continue to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, hallelujah. You are the reason why we are here today. Glory to God, hallelujah. At this time, just keep the worship going. Hallelujah, glory to God. We're going to have a presentation of the theme, glory to God, in the form of a drama. Glory to God, hallelujah. And we're going to make them welcome. Hallelujah.
Jesus, 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 Jesus. Come on, call a sweet name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Nothing. The dance group, will you be presenting? Nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Come on, let's worship the Lord. Jesus, you're the center, and everything revolves around you. Jesus, you. Come on, can we have the presentation of the theme? Nothing else matters, and nothing in this world.
Praise the Lord Jesus. As we wait on our young people to get ready for with their presentation, we just want to take the time out to welcome all our overseas delegates from Avon Park. Just give us a hallelujah shout. We're happy to have you. We're happy to have you. Welcome, 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 welcome to Youth Day of Convocation 2024. Praise the Lord Jesus. Amen. And I know that you will enjoy this presentation put on by our young people in the name of Jesus. God bless you all. Love you all.
Hallelujah. Hello? Yeah, girl, must say, me a tell you about the cute boy, see? The cute one way in our class, man. Girl, must say, boy, looks so good. Oh my God, man. I say, girl.
Girl, a wagwan.
No, man, wait, hold on there. I'm call you back.
Wagwan, girl.
I say, Shanae, if you ever know, I say, girl, that's what me with them call Christian life. You see, it's so hard.
I say, girl, I'm going to take it up. And you know, see, I'm me alone in my family, a Christian, because we host all of the party and things them.
Jesus.
I'm going to take up that Christian something here. And me, I tell you, say it hard. Everybody I reject me. Them I call me old woman. Them say I'm so backslide. Them I treat me bad.
Lord, you think of that alone? I say, girl, I say, this cute boy in my class, you see? I have one piece of boyfriend day. And you know more than the things a boyfriend and girlfriend do. Yes. But it's so hard because we are Christian and they might tell us to live right. And boy, temptation, me I tell you.
And not only that, I go take up this nursing thing for my head, girl. It's hard. And then me a Christian, I'm a barely a scrape through. I see people who are unsafe, I get higher grades than me. And everybody I say, make God bring you through, make God bring you through. But I'm still just a scrape through.
Girl, me don't know where we are going. Me don't know where we are going. It's so hard.
Hi. You know, I was just passing and I hear your conversation. And yes, the struggle is real as young Christians. But have you ever heard about Joseph?
The cute boy in our class?
Not that Joseph. Yes, him cute because he was an Israelite. Him have all the triceps and the biceps and him they look good bad. But not that one we are talking about. We are talking about Joseph, the one who understand who he was and he understood the structure of the kingdom. So guess what? Come, let me tell you about the story of Joseph.
The story was told of a young man by the name of Joseph. He was born in the town of Haran to his parents Jacob and Rachel. At the age of 6, he left Haran along with his family and journeyed to the land of Canaan, eventually settling in Hebron. Jacob, his father, displayed extra affection to Joseph because he was born to him in old age, presenting him with a specially crafted garment, a coat of many colors. This prompted feelings of jealousy within his brothers, especially the sons of Jacob's other wife, Leah. These ill feelings grew even more when Joseph repeated 2 of his dreams to them, in which he was portrayed as ruling over his siblings. Soon enough, when Joseph was 17, the tension and the jealousy grew to the point of complete hatred. One day, Jacob instructed Joseph to visit his brothers in Shechem, where they were tending their sheep. Little did he know that this would be the last time he would see his dear son. Seizing their chance, the brothers saw Joseph, and conspired to kill him. Reuben convinced them to throw Joseph into the pit instead. A short while later, they spotted an Arab caravan passing the scene, and the brothers sold Joseph to the traders. Betrayed by family, rejected, and almost left for dead was the path of a young man who chose to put God first.
Rejected. Rejection. Nobody likes you. Nobody wants you.
Dream Chaser, Jesus Tracer, Big Shot, or so you think, only to discover the ones who you thought were with you are against you, and the ones who you thought loved you will betray you. The hurt. How do you bounce from this? It was not a stranger. It was my family, my church brethren. But it was all a plan. It was in God's hand. For what was to kill me became my victory. So yes, it hurts. I cry to sleep considering the pain. But I choose to forgive regardless. There is purpose in my pain, a victory in my defeat, because I know it will all make sense if I lay it at God's feet.
Joseph was eventually brought to Egypt, where he was sold to Potiphar, one of King Pharaoh's ministers. For a while, things started to look up for young Joseph. Divine success enabled him to find favor in his master's eyes, and he was appointed head of Potiphar's estate. However, this would not last for long. Attracted by his handsome looks, Potiphar's wife desired to be intimate with Joseph. To her disappointment, Joseph continuously refused. One day, when no one was home other than the two of them, the mistress grasped Joseph's garment, demanding that he consent. Thinking quickly, Joseph slid out of his coat and ran outside. But Potiphar's wife turned the tables on Joseph, telling her that it was Joseph who had tried to entice her. The angry master reacted by placing his trustworthy assistant in prison.
Get your Bible, your iPhone, your iPad, your galaxy, Android, or your favorite Bibles. I hope you can get somebody. convocation, first of all, right now, you ain't being tempted, no friends, and nobody else. Everybody's being tempted by something. Everybody has something that gets their attention and pulls them out. So we all being tempted, we all are being tempted, we all have some kind of temptation. But here's what I'm like, God, but God, here it is, right verse 6, but God is faithful. That's a shouting point, God is faithful. Somebody call back, say God is faithful. I'm coming in for a close, I'm bringing my plane in for a landing, but you gotta get this right here, that you can't depend on anything else, but you can depend on this, that God is faithful. What is he faithful? He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. It's such a promise. In the Bible, God, he said, but he will, with the temptation, will also make the way to escape that you may be able to bear. Stop on this point right here, that when temptation walks in the house, standing right next to it is a way out of escape. Oh, I wish I could hear a shout from somebody who wants to.
But Joseph's charisma followed him to prison, and the warden soon appointed him as his right-hand man. In time, his unique qualities expressed themselves in an additional area. When the king's royal cupbearer and baker were imprisoned, Joseph successfully interpreted their dreams, correctly predicting that the cupbearer would be released and the baker hanged. Joseph maintained the right attitude and the right perspective because he knew that his God would never, ever fail. Like any young person, he would have been both discouraged at times and maybe even anxious about the unknown, but his feelings did not determine his faith.
You did not create me to fear. that's a name. I'm not gonna let them come here now. Learn, please. But it's not for crossroads.
Years later, King Pharaoh himself envisioned two dreams, which none of his advisors were able to explain. Impressed by Joseph's wisdom, Pharaoh appointed him as his viceroy, second only to the king himself, and tasked Joseph with readying the nation for the years of famine. Meanwhile, the effects of the famine were felt in Canaan. Hearing that there was grain in Egypt, Joseph's brothers journeyed there to buy precious food from the viceroy, not realizing that he was their very own brother. Joseph decided to utilize this opportunity to observe whether his brothers truly regretted having sold him. Using a succession of dramatic maneuvers, Joseph tested his brothers' determination to save their youngest brother, Benjamin, Joseph's only maternal brother, from the plot he set up for him. Once he saw that their devotion toward Benjamin was good, Joseph finally revealed his identity to his astonished siblings. Following the heartfelt reunion, Joseph invited his father and his brothers to move to Egypt where he could provide for them. Joseph concluded that what was meant for evil against him, God can always, always turn it around for good. If we only obey the Lord in all that we do, put him first and trust in him. Just as God did for Joseph, he will do it for you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's get a praise the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Do we see why the enemy is fighting the young people? Hallelujah. Aren't they talented? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Announcement. There's a white Toyota Fila. License plate 7909HB is blocking someone on the outside.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Come on, let's stand to our feet. It's time for our Bishop, glory to God. You're going to do a song? All right, so come on, people. Let us stand to our feet. We're going to have a song, and then we're going to welcome our bishop. We're going to sing and worship. Come on, stand to your feet. Glory to God.
Magnify the name of God. Hallelujah. Can we just give thanks to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Can we just give thanks for all that he has done for us and all that he's going to continue to do for us? Can we just praise God? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Just lift up his name, hallelujah. Just praise him. Just think about what he brought you out of to put you where you are today. Just give him praise. Come on, just praise God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm the salt of the earth. I'm the salt of the earth. I carry the flavor of God. I season the earth. Oh, I'm the salt of the earth. I'm the salt of the earth. I carry the flavor of God. I season the earth. I'm the salt.
I'm the salt of the earth. I'm the salt of the earth.
I carry
the flavor of God. Of God.
I season
the earth.
Oh, I'm the salt.
I'm the salt of the earth. I'm the salt of the earth. I carry the flavor of God. I season the earth.
I'm the light.
I'm the light of the world. I'm the light of the world.
I carry
the flavor of God. I season the earth. The light of the world.
Oh,
I'm the light of the world. I shine the light
of God.
Of God.
I season
the earth.
I'm the salt. I'm the salt.
I'm the salt of the earth. I'm the salt of the earth. I carry the flavor of God. I season the earth.
Oh, I live to dominate.
To dominate.
Surely there is no enchantment against me. No divination against me. I am covered. Oh, I live to dominate.
I live to dominate.
Surely, surely,
surely there is no enchantment against
no
me.
Divination
no divination
against me.
Against me.
I am covered.
Oh,
I live to dominate.
I live to dominate.
Surely, surely,
surely there is no enchantment against
no
me. No divination I can't see.
I am covered.
Oh, I'm highly favored. I'm highly favored in Jesus' name.
Say, I'm highly favored. Say,
I'm highly favored. I'm highly favored. I'm highly favored. I'm highly favored in Jesus' name.
I'm highly, highly favored. Say,
I'm highly favored. I'm highly favored. I'm highly favored. I'm highly favored in Jesus' name.
I'm the salt of the earth.
I'm the salt of the earth. I'm the salt of the earth. I carry the flavor of God. I season the earth.
Oh, I'm the salt. Say,
I'm the salt of the earth. I'm the salt of the earth.
I carry
the flavor
of God.
Of God.
I season
the earth.
I'm the salt. I'm the salt. Yeah.
I'm the salt of the earth.
Oh.
I'm the salt of the earth. I carry the flavor of God. I season the earth.
Oh. I carry the flavor
of God.
I
season the earth.
I carry the flavor of God.
I season the earth.
I live to dominate it.
I live to dominate.
To dominate.
Surely there is no enchantment against me. No divination I can see. I am covered.
Oh, I live to dominate it.
I live to dominate.
Surely
there is no enchantment against me.
No divination against me.
I can't see.
I am covered.
I'm highly favored. I'm highly favored in Jesus' name.
I'm highly favored
in Jesus' name.
I'm the salt, yes,
I'm the salt of the earth. I'm the salt of the earth. I carry the flavor of God. I season the earth.
I'm the light
of the world.
Oh,
I'm the light of the world. I shine the light
of God
upon the earth.
Oh, I carry the flavor
of God. I season the earth.
I carry
the flavor of God. I season the earth.
Do you believe what you just sang? Are you the salt of the earth this morning? Hallelujah. We can't lose a little savor, right? Glory to God. Anybody ever taste food without salt? Anybody ever taste food without salt? It tastes nice, delicious. Come on, people, I'm not hearing you. Anybody at all ever eat food without salt? Glory to God, it can't taste nice. So if God said we are the salt of the earth, let us season the earth. Amen? Glory to God. I'm going to ask you to stand again, and we're going to make our bishop welcome at this time. Glory to God. Come on, stand to your feet. Glory to God. And continue to worship the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Just touch your neighbor and say, you are salt. Come on, talk to somebody beside you. You are salt and you are light. You're not so sure. Come on, tell everybody. You are salt. And you are light. Talk to somebody. You are salt and you are light. Salt, you give flavor and you preserve. Light, you give direction to those who are in darkness. Put your hand together and bless the name of the Lord. Greeting you today, the first full day of our convocation, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We started last night. What a time we had last night. Come on, put your hand together and bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Didn't the preacher preach? Yes, he did. He did. And we are very proud. Amen. And I hope that we got the message. Amen. We got the message. The kingdom. The gospel of the kingdom. And finish the work that the Lord has given to you. What's your assignment? Thank God. If at this age and time in my life I don't know my assignment, that would be a tragedy. Hello. And some of us in the beginning of our career, we don't exactly know where the Lord is leading us. But as time develops, we find out what we're called to do. Amen. Thank God I've found out what the Lord has called me to do. And I want to finish and finish well. There's no prize for a good beginning. The prize is for well done. Amen? Come on, lift your hands and give God a praise. Late Bishop Sidney Alexander Dunn and I used to have some lovely jokes. And he said to me, Woolsworth, when we go to England, when you go to heaven, I'm going to say, well, Woolsworth, he's going to say, well done. Because you know his name was Dunn. Well done. Amen? Praise God. So you're not going to hear anything but well done. Thank God for young people today. This session was well done. Come on. Hallelujah. If you believe it's well done, stand to your feet and salute our young people and clap them and said, well done. Everybody on their feet, man. Come on, come on, come on. You must be learning to give compliments. Give compliments where compliments is due. Come on, lift your hands and give God a praise. I like to give compliments because I'm not jealous. When people do well, I'm glad. You may be seated. I'm just glad to see people do well. Amen. Thank God for this session. And we've just begun. Amen. Thank God for those who are visiting with us. If you're here today from another church other than Greater Grace, let me see your hand. Anybody from another church? Okay, there's one hand there. You're from? Which church are you from? Huh? No, you're from Concert. You're from Greater Grace. All right, good. Thank you. Greater Grace. All right, so all of us here are from Greater Grace. Isn't that wonderful? Amen. Hallelujah. God is good. We thank God for those who are here from Florida. Amen. Led by our precious Bishop Wayne Williams and First Lady Williams, who have become an integral part of Greater Grace right now. Amen. Come on and put your hand together and bless the Lord for them. Thank God for all those who are with them in their party. Elder Morris, Elder Isaacs, praise God. Sister Britannia, amen. Sister Clear, and Sister, Jennifer, right? Praise God. Amen. Just give thanks for you, Pastor Maxwell. God bless you. And we have with us today, amen, also Minister Darren Lambley coming to us for the first time in Jamaica. Where's Minister Lambley? All right. And yesterday, this morning, he had his first Jamaican breakfast. Come on and give God praise. Hallelujah. Wonderful young man. And I know we are ready to hear the word in the what we call the plenary session. But since our brother's here for the first time, and he's also the youth pastor of the Lighthouse Church of Christ, amen, pastored by Pastor Maxwell, amen, we're going to ask Minister Darren Lambley just to come on here and to greet you and say what the Lord lays on heart for 5 minutes before the preacher comes. God bless him as he comes in Jesus' name. Make him welcome. Come on and praise the Lord.
Come on and praise the Lord this morning. Come on and give God some praise, young people. Amen. I'm just glad to be in the house of God again. Bishop just came up to me and said, he said, you're the youth minister, right? I said, yes, sir. He's like, well, just give me a couple of minutes. I said, okay, a couple minutes. But just giving honor to Bishop Holdsworth, Bishop Williams, all the bishops, the pastors, the elders, the ministers, and everyone else in their respective places, the first ladies, deacon stewards and trustees. My pastor, Pastor Maxwell. What came to me was the skit they did, the skit with Joseph, and how he was considered the favorite son at the time because he was the youngest, he was the baby. So if all the parents, you know how it is with the young people, usually the baby is the one you coddle. The baby is the one that you cherish, you take care of. And with that, he gave Joseph a coat of many colors because he was his favorite. He was special to him. He took care of him. So I want the young people to realize, you have to realize you're God's favorite. You're standing, you're living on the word of God, you're testifying, you're being a witness, you're being a light. And when you have that light, God puts that special covering on you. He puts that special coat on you. And with that coat, you become a target. Because people see that anointing. They see how you move. And not only do they want that anointing, but they know it's something they don't have that they want. And when you have that anointing, that presence of God on you, the attack begins. And I just want to say to the young people to be encouraged, stick together, have a prayer life. If the pastor asks you to participate, even if you don't understand, just participate. Because we have to trust that God has a way for us. God has a will for us. Amen? Amen. And we saw in the story with Joseph, he trusted God's word. He stuck with his plan. It didn't go according to what he wished. But in the end, we see how it worked out for him and his people. It worked out for the Israelites. It worked out for his family. Everything went against them. But in the end, it worked out. And Bishop, that's all the words. I ain't going to hold it too long. So y'all, again, y'all pray my strength in the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Put your hand together for Brother Lamley. Come on. Come on and bless the Lord. You can do better than that. Come on, bless the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, his first time on this soil. But you know, this thing is contagious. Once you come, you can't leave. It is said that when you go to Avon Park and drink Avon Park water, you have to come back. Amen. And we've been going back. I've been going back now for the last 10, 15 years. Drink too much of the water. Amen. But I'm glad. These people are some of the most hospitable people I know. You didn't hear me. Say they're some of the most hospitable people I know. And when you go abroad, you want to know you're treated right. Come on, put your hand together and bless the name of the Lord. On this last trip, some of the young people here went with me. Jordan, you can say, right? Come and tell him how you were treated. Come on, come on. Come on up here and tell him how you were treated at Avon Park. Come on, put your hand together for Jordan. Yes. He was on a trip, and he played the bass down there. Amen. Yes.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Yes, they treat me very well. It's like I'm put on weight. So, yeah, I really enjoy myself there. I really spend most of my time over there, and truly it is a blessing to meet some of my, you know, family. It's not my friends, no. It's my church family. It's a blessing to meet them in the house of the Lord. So I really do enjoy myself. And my sisters and my other sister, they really appreciate as how you guys treat us. Thank you again.
Praise God. Come on, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Amen. Now, you notice that it says, they're now my family. Amen. And that's how you know. You have to connect. Everybody say connect. Thank God Jesus came and connected with me. Amen. I know I have a beautiful, not only a family, but I have a great Father. Amen. Because the Father was manifested in the Son. Come on and give God a praise. And somebody said, where's the Father? And Jesus said, oh my God, so long have I been with you, and you have not known me. I am in the Father in me. If you don't know me, know that, believe it for the work's sake. Everybody say, the work's sake. And that's what God is calling us to do, to work. Amen. You're going to be paid for your work. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. We have to be the God's servant and speaker at this time in our main session. None other than Bishop Wayne Williams. Amen. Hallelujah. Bishop Wayne need no introduction to this church. He'd been coming here for years at Convocation. And I'm glad I met this young man many years ago and his dear wife. In fact, she will tell you, I baptized her in Jesus' name. And I tarried with her for the Holy Ghost. And she got the Holy Ghost. Come on and give God a praise. Let's praise the name of the Lord. And many others. You know, one of the joys is to go to different places around the world and people tell you, you preached when I got saved, or you helped me to know the way and find the way.
That's my greatest joy. My greatest joy not to have a big church, not to have a big name, is to be a soul winner for the Lord Jesus Christ. And I really mean that. Come on and bless God. Hallelujah. Daniel says, amen, they that, amen, win many for the Lord shall shine as the stars from heaven. What a wonderful thing. Look at your neighbor and say, are you a soul winner? Come on, come on, come on. Are you a soul winner? Didn't ask you if you're a bishop. Didn't ask you if you're a minister. Didn't ask you if you're an evangelist. Didn't ask you if you're an apostle. And you're not going to get anything for any of these titles. You're going to get it because you're a worker. Amen. You're being paid for your work. A lot of bishops aren't going to get anything because they are not workers. Jesus said, the harvest is truly plenteous. He didn't say the ministers are few. Didn't say the bishops are few because there are a whole lot of them. But he says the workers or the laborers are few. Come on, somebody, let's praise God. Let's praise the name of the Lord. So I want to be a laborer in the vineyard. Stand to your feet at this time. Amen. And make welcome, amen, Bishop Wayne Williams. I said he needs no introduction. He is the pastor of the Avon Park, amen, Victory Tabernacle Church International. Amen. He'll be assisted by our good friend and brother, if he chooses to use him this time or next week. Next Monday, I don't know how they share it. But we have also Bishop, amen, hallelujah, Benjamin Carter in the house. Come on and bless the name of the Lord. Great servant of the Lord. Man with knowledge and understanding and wisdom. And we are so happy to have him in convocation. Put your hand together for him. Hallelujah. So God bless them as a minister in Jesus' name. Bishop Williams.
Thank you, Bishop. Praise the Lord, everybody. Clap your hands, all ye people. And shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Has God been good to you? Amen. I want to turn our attention and just put our hands together for a man of a great God, none other than Bishop Dr. C.A. Holdsworth. Hallelujah. Thank God for him. God bless you. You may be seated. We're so grateful for the relationship that we have shared with Bishop Holdsworth and Lady Holdsworth, and also with the saints here at Greater Grace Temple, especially those who were here from the very beginning. We remember when service used to be on the other side. We remember when there was a big tree that was standing right where this church is. We remember some years ago, Youth Day, or National Youth Day, was held right here at 65 Adina Road. And we had a band that marched around the community. Anybody remember that? Amen. Missionary Mighty would say, mighty long way, Lord. Mighty long way. And so we're grateful to the Lord for his goodness and for his mercies that he has extended to us. And also, together with my wife and all those who came along from Victory Tabernacle in Avon Park, we are so appreciative of Bishop Holdsworth and Pastor Anne-Marie Roden and the young people that came to our most recent convocation. Amen. I told Pastor Roden that your presence, the presence of you and the young people and Bishop, really added value to our convocation. It was an awesome time, and we felt that we wanted to hold on to Brother Jordan. He didn't really want to leave. Amen. But we're so grateful for their passion for the kingdom of God. And we're so grateful that they are a model and an example to others in the kingdom, to let them know that young people can serve God and stay in the church. Amen. Praise God. And our young people were also impacted by your presence, and we want to give God thanks for that. I'm so grateful also for my wife, Arlene Williams. Thank God for her. You can put your hands together for her. And she's not my daughter-in-law, but she was my daughter before she became daughter-in-law. None other than Sister Britannia Thomas Williams. Put your hands together. Can you understand and let them see you? Amen. Praise God. And to Sister Jennifer and Sister Claire Samuels, put your hands together for them. I call them, along with my wife, the three musketeers. They're always together, always always working together, and we thank God for them. So good to have Elder Michael Isaacs with us, coming all the way from Avon Park as well. Put your hands together for him. And Bishop Carter, of course, has been officially a Jamaican, and he looks forward to come to this convocation every year. Unforeseen circumstances prevented him last year, and of course COVID prevented all of us in the previous years, but we're so grateful that COVID or no COVID, he's here with us this year. Somebody ought to give God praise for that. And for Pastor Daniel Maxwell, this, I didn't realize it was actually his third visit to Jamaica. His wife is a Jamaican, and God's willing, she will be here this coming Wednesday, Sunday night, right? Sunday night. Amen. Praise God. So we look forward to having her joining him as he ministers the word of the Lord. And to, of course, our own Elder Morris, he almost didn't come to this trip, but I think he could not imagine himself not coming. Because this week, I think tomorrow will be his wife's birthday, and he really wanted to stay to celebrate the birthday with her. But he's here because she knows where his heart is, and she gave him her blessing so that he could come to this convocation. And we want to give God thanks for that. Amen. And for Minister Lamley, whom I've just met yesterday, well, officially, we're so grateful that he's able to work with us and acclimatize to the culture of Jamaica. We're so thankful for, and I know the next time he comes, he possibly will bring his wife to be a part of this service. Can we just put our hands together for all these great men and women of God? Thank God for their faithfulness, for always coming. We have some persons, other persons, who would like to come and be a part of this great convocation. And so maybe next year, if the Lord tarries, we look forward to having some other members of our congregation to be a part of it. And I know that more of you will be coming to Avon Park sooner than later. I heard the young people declare that they are favored by God, and I believe that God is going to open doors for our young people in this church. Do we have any believers? Amen. We believe that God is going to open the door. So to all the other ministers who are here, I thought I saw Elder Stennett, but probably I'm not seeing right. And to all the young people who are celebrating, who is conducting the service today, God bless you. So sorry we missed. Well, I missed the first portion, but I was indeed blessed by the reenactment of the story of Joseph. Recently, I shared a message entitled The Four Coats of Joseph. The first coat was the coat of favor. Amen. And he got another coat when he went to be the slave in the house of Potiphar. That was his second coat. And the third coat, is it four coat I talked about, or was it three coat? And we talk about when he was in prison, and also we talk about the coat that he received when he was placed in an exalted position. I believe that God is positioning our young people, and thank God for a bishop who's making room for our young people to expand and to grow in the kingdom of God. We're not waiting until we die. We are seeing you in action while we are yet alive. Somebody need to celebrate God for that, for our young people. Come on, put your hands together one more time and praise God. So today I have the responsibility to look at the subject matter that this convocation is focusing on, and that is the gospel of the kingdom. And today's sub-theme, we are focusing on the structure of the kingdom, the structure of the kingdom of God. I believe that the season and the time is appropriate for us to revisit something that was at the very heart of Jesus. As a prelude to his coming or to his manifestation as Israel's Messiah, he had a forerunner by the name of John the Baptist. And John had a singular message. And the singular message that John the Baptist had was repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. We will see this reflected in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. In the book of Matthew, you will see the reference to the kingdom of God as, in the words, the kingdom of heaven. In the other Gospels, particularly in the Gospel according to Mark and Luke, they would use the terminology, the kingdom of God. And theologians have gone through laboriously trying to distinguish between the two terminology, but they are one and the same. They mean the same thing. And the reason why in the book of Matthew, the gospel according to Matthew, the kingdom of heaven was the term that was used because of the audience, which was typically the Jewish audience that Brother Matthew was addressing. So the term kingdom of heaven was one of those terminologies that they use as a circumlocution, meaning instead of using the tetragrammaton name of God, Yahweh, what the Jewish people would do is find other titles or name so that they would not defy the commandment of the Lord that says you must not take the name of the Lord in vain. So whenever they refer to the kingdom of heaven in a Jewish context, they are referring to a name that they use instead of using the term Yahweh. So today we're going to explore, and hopefully time will permit us. Bishop Carter is here, and of course Pastor Maxwell is also here, and the Lord so allows it to be, would love to have their thoughts on areas that I may not be able to cover. The preamble that was given to me was in the form of a question, and it goes like this. Our place in the kingdom was at the heart of the message of Jesus. And so the question is, what is the kingdom of God as taught by Jesus? Now, if Jesus spent so much time talking about the kingdom, it must be an important subject. And it begs to ask the question, why has the church laboriously or intentionally avoid the subject of the kingdom? And because of that, it leads us down a very negative path. And we get to a place where we begin to take ownership of the church that don't belong to man. It belongs to who? It belongs to God. When we speak of the kingdom of God, it brings things back into focus and into perspective. I'm going to ask you to use up your Bibles today. So if you have your Bibles, I want you to go to Luke chapter number 22 and verse number 29. And if you have it on your phone or whatever device is, I want you to explore the word of the Lord with me today. So in Luke chapter 22, quoting from the New International Version, hear what it says. And I confer on you a kingdom just as my Father conferred one on me. So this was Jesus talking to the disciples. And in essence, what Jesus was saying, I am conferring, I am transferring a kingdom to you just as my Father has transferred or conveyed a kingdom to me. So Jesus is simply following what God had directed him to do. You will remember when Jesus was 12 years old, that he went into the temple and his parents lost him. I have a friend of mine. They were coming from New York and they stopped in the Carolinas. After they stopped for a brief break, they were heading towards Florida, and so they left Carolina and they were driving south, and a few miles down the road they realized that one of their daughters was not in the vehicle. And they didn't realize until she got a phone and called them, said, "Daddy, you guys left me." And then they looked around and realized that she was indeed missing. I'm saying that because sometimes we get hard on ourselves when certain unfortunate things happen. It shouldn't happen, but things happen. Isn't that right? Things happen. And it happened to Jesus, his parents. If it happened to the parents of Jesus, certainly it can happen to anybody. So his mother and father, they left him. They supposed that he was with other family members, only to realize that I believe that they were 3 days into the journey before they missed Jesus. They were 3 days almost home, and they recognized that Jesus was not in their midst. But watch this. They went back to where they thought they lost him. And rightly so, Jesus was in the temple. What was he doing in the temple? The Bible says he was asking questions and he was also providing answers. When the meeting was done, the parents said to him, "Son, why have you done this to us?" And I always laugh at that because Jesus didn't leave them. They left him. And they're asking him. It sounds like some of our parents. Isn't that right? Our parents don't like to take responsibility. They like to turn it around to the children and blame them. But Lord, help us in Jesus' name. But Jesus responds. He said, "Wist you not, you don't know, that I must be about my father's business." And what was his father's business? His father's business was revealed in the text after Jesus was tempted for 40 days. That was preceded by his baptism in the Jordan River by John Baptist. Then he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness for 40 days that he fasted. And when he came back, the Bible said he went into the temple. He was invited to read from the scroll. He took the scroll and he read from the prophet Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel," condensed version, "to the poor, to heal the broken heart," etc., etc. And the Bible says he closed the book and then he became the book. Because in the book of the Psalm said, it is written of me in the volume of the book. And so when Jesus came, if you read in Matthew chapter number 4, the Bible says that everywhere Jesus went, his message was characterized by the presence of miracles, signs, and wonders. And that was because the message that he was preaching was the message of the kingdom of God. Whenever we talk about the kingdom of God, we're talking about God in action. Can you say that with me? Whenever we talk about the kingdom of God, we're talking about God in action. So whenever we talk about the kingdom of God, we're talking about God in action. So the kingdom of God was the major theme of the ministry of Jesus. And it was his favorite description of what God is doing in the world. As a matter of fact, one time he dispatched the disciples. And this is what he told them. He said, wherever you go, you must tell them that the kingdom of God is at hand. And every time he said that, every time they would say that, it would be characterized with miracles, signs, and wonders. I don't know about you, but I believe that we're living in a season and a time when we need to see the manifestation of the kingdom of God in our lifetime. Do I have a witness? Amen. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor it's time for kingdom manifestation. So Jesus also used many kingdom parables. He talked about the kingdom of God is like, as you read through the Gospels, he will make mention that the kingdom of God is like a merchant man. It is like so and so. He used many things to teach different aspects of the kingdom, because one cannot effectively use one lesson to describe all that the kingdom encompasses. It is not just one thing. It is many things. The word kingdom is used more than 150 times in the New Testament. So you know that something is of importance when you see it reoccurring in the scriptures over and over again. And so when we read in the New Testament scriptures, we see the term kingdom, and it has been used over 150 times. Even in what we traditionally call the Lord's Prayer, we always say, thy will be done, thy kingdom come. In Matthew 6, verse 33, we hear the Lord said, seek ye first, what? The kingdom of God. So Jesus not only preached it, but he commanded his followers to seek after or to seek for the kingdom of God. Again, that points to the importance of the kingdom of God. But what does that really mean when we talk about the kingdom of God? What does it really mean when we talk about seeking the kingdom of God? What does it look like living and being a part of the kingdom of God? I want to make reference to something real quickly before I go any further. In the early, in the Middle Ages, in the early 1500s, there were individuals who emerged in the church world that discovered, as soon as the printing press was delivered, was created, books of the scriptures started to be printed, and it was now, the Bible itself was now made available to the common people. Prior to the 15th century, the only persons who really have copies of the scriptures were, for instance, like the priest, the bishops, and the popes. And so the ordinary people in that time did not have access to the scriptures. So there were many teachings that evolved in the early church. Things like purgatory, things like indulgences that were manufactured within the Catholic Church. These things were man-made doctrines that were implemented in the church at the expense of the poor people. But when the printing press came in and people now had access to the actual reading of the scripture, they recognized some of the practices of the priests, the bishops, the popes, and the people of their time were not according to scripture. And so the people started to revolt. So there were men like Martin Luther, a great philosopher. There were others like John Calvin, Charles Wesley, John Wesley, William Tyndale, men like Jonathan Edwards, John Knox, John Wycliffe, Ulrich Zwingli, and many others who came after them, who what we call were reformers of the time. So in the 15th century, some of these reformers emerged like Luther. It is traditionally believed that he nailed his 95 thesis of what he believed to be counteracting to the Catholic Church on the door of the church to show that he was opposing what the Catholic Church was teaching. We have very little evidence that he actually nailed anything on the door, but what we do have is the actual documentation that Martin Luther sent his 95 theses to the Pope and to the bishops, requiring a debate concerning things that the scriptures teach, and it was counteracting what the bishops and the popes were teaching. In so these men developed what we now call the Kingdom Reformation. The Kingdom Reformation. People were going back to the early church. They were going back to what the early church really preached, believed, and practiced. Now, Kingdom Reformation began with the transition from the temple to the church and from Jewish leaders to church leaders. So what God was doing, when Jesus came on the scene, he started a reformation, because now he was shifting things from the temple worship to church. And he was shifting leadership from Jewish leaders to church leaders, according to a renowned doctor by the name of Dana Carson. Dana Carson said, Pentecost officially begins the first formal actions of the Messianic or Kingdom Reformation, beginning with the birth of the church on the day of Pentecost. The church is the formal institution or organization that is the bedrock of Reformation. Now, there is a distinction between the church and the kingdom of God, but God uses the church to advance his kingdom. Can somebody say amen? It's not the kingdom, but it is used as an instrument in the hand of God to advance the kingdom of God. The church becomes the organism that houses the reformed leadership structure. So one of the first things that Jesus did was to reform the leadership structure of the church by transitioning from the then known existing leadership that involved priests, Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, the Sanhedrin, the chief high priest, etc., to what is now called the fivefold ministry of apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, according to Paul's writing in Ephesians chapter number 4, verse number 11. So what God did when he established the church was to change the leadership structure. Somebody said leadership structure. And so now we have the apostles, we have the prophets, we have the evangelists, we have the pastors, and we have the teachers. From a theological perspective, some people say it's four, because they combine pastors and teachers together. We're going to adopt, for the purpose of this teaching, the fivefold ministry of the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers. These offices are important. They are more important in terms of their function than they are in their titles. Most time people are caught up with the position or the title of an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher, more than they are concerning the function. What the scripture is emphasizing is not the title of the person, but is emphasizing the function that these offices hold. Can somebody say amen? And the reason why, personally, I believe that these offices are still required for the modern day church. It is explained in the scriptures that God has given these what we call ministry gifts as a gift to the body of Christ, meaning that these individuals that carries or function in these offices are God's gift to the church. So the apostle is not just a gift, but the person who carries that position or that title or that function is really God's gift to the church. So the apostle is a gift to the church. The prophet is a gift to the church. The evangelist is a gift to the church. The pastor is a gift to the church. The teacher is a gift to the church. So for instance, Bishop Holdsworth, he serves as the senior pastor of Greater Grace Temple. Bishop is God's gift to Greater Grace Temple. Can somebody say amen? We celebrate him, but we celebrate the man. We celebrate the person who he is. He is not carrying a gift. He is the gift to the body of Christ. Can somebody give God praise for the gift of the pastor? Come on, give the Lord praise for the gift of the pastor. Right now, he is not only the pastor or the senior pastor of Greater Grace Temple, but he is a bishop because now he's the pastor of pastors. So God has elevated him to the place where he functions differently. He's not just pastoring Greater Grace Temple, but he's pastoring Greater Grace Temple family of churches and all those who will seek his guidance and his leadership. Can we celebrate God's gift to the body of Christ? Come on, put your hands together and celebrate God's gift. Hear what the Apostle Paul said. That's not my main aim today, but I want to make this point. Paul said these are gifts to the body of Christ. Why? For, number one, for the perfecting of the saints. Number two, for the work of the ministry. And number three, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Watch this. Till we all come into the unity of the faith and of the full measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. In other words, this structure that God imparts or sets up in the church is designed to make us to become like Christ. So until all these offices or all these functions begin to operate in the kingdom as God designed, the church will be in limbo and will not be perfected as God designed. But I believe as we're living in the hour and the time in which we're living in, that God is bringing that fivefold ministry together so that the church can be perfected. And when the church is perfected, guess who's going to come back? Guess who's going to come back? Guess who's going to come back? Say it like you really believe in that. Guess who's going to come back? Jesus is going to return for his bride without spots or wrinkle. Anybody expecting the Lord to burst the clouds asunder and call you home? Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. So God has established these individuals in the body so that he can structure the kingdom according to his design. And that is one of the reasons why we are here today. So here are a few questions we are going to address. Number one, where is the kingdom? Look at your neighbor and ask them, where is the kingdom? I'm glad you asked. Now, the kingdom of God is wherever Jesus is king. Let me say that again. The kingdom of God is wherever Jesus is king. So if Jesus is king in your heart, then the kingdom of God is within you. Remember that God confer a kingdom to you. So if he's your king, then the kingdom is where? On the inside of you. Luke chapter 17, verse number 20. Chapter 17, verse 20 and 21 in the New King James Version reads, now when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, listen to this carefully, the kingdom of God does not come with observation. Nor will they say, see there, see here, or see there. For indeed, the kingdom of God is within you. So I want every believer in this house to understand that the kingdom of God is resident in your heart. And because the kingdom of God is resident in your heart, you are no longer an ordinary person. Can somebody praise him? Hallelujah. Tell somebody the kingdom of God is within you. And because the kingdom is within you, you are not an ordinary person. So even when we pray, we must not come to God like we're begging him. Have you ever heard some saints praying, Lord, begging you to do this, I'm begging you to do that? When you begin to beg God, you're not operating in your kingship. You're not operating as someone who has the kingdom of God on the inside. As a matter of fact, the Apostle John said, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. So if the kingdom of God is inside of you, it means that God has given you dominion and rulership in the earth. And if God has made you a ruler, or if he has given you dominion, it means that the devil is not above you, he's under your feet. Hear what the Bible says, that God had highly exalted Jesus and given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, what will happen? Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. But watch this, the Bible says, not only has God exalted him, given him a name that is above every name, but you and I positionally are in Christ. And if Christ is far above all principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places, how is it that you have the devil living in your house and you can't sleep in your bed because some duppy has been released? Oh, can somebody give God a praise this house? Somebody shout, the kingdom of God is within me. Come on, put your hand on your chest. The kingdom of God is within me. Somebody praise the name of the Lord. The second thing is, if Jesus, as we said, is king in your heart, then the kingdom of God is within you. Now, because Jesus is king in heaven, then the kingdom of God also is in heaven. That is why you can't just say the kingdom of God is this or just this. The kingdom of God is so much more. So because Jesus is king in heaven, the Bible says that the kingdom of God is also in heaven. If you read Psalm 103 verse 19, the scripture reads in the New King James Version, the Lord has established his throne in heaven and his kingdom rules over all. Let me read it again. The Lord has established his throne in heaven and his kingdom rules over all. So the idea about the kingdom of God predated even the New Testament, because it speaks of God's rulership. It speaks of God's governance. If you read in Psalm 115, I believe this was one of your theme several years ago. In Psalm 115, the Bible says that God reserved the heaven for himself, but he's given the earth to the children of men. In other words, in this kingdom operation, God reserved heaven for himself, but he has given to us as members of his kingdom dominion over the earth. Let me elaborate on that a little bit. Now God, he rules in the heaven. Tell your neighbor, God rules in the heaven. But there are things on the earth that you and I are responsible for. There's something that we are praying about that we should not be praying about. We should be doing something about it. When God created Adam and placed him in the Garden of Eden, I think it's Genesis 1 verse number 26, the Bible says, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. Verse number 27, and God made man in his own image and in his likeness, male and female created he them. The next thing that God did was to give dominion to Adam and to Eve. Dominion means that he gave them the power to rule the earth. God's intention was not for man to rule man. God's intention was for God to rule the creation that he has established. Can somebody say amen? That is why the animals were designed to respect you. The birds were designed to respect you. The sea creatures were designed to respect you because you have the dominion over this earth realm. In order for the enemy, that is Satan, to gain access and to have any rulership on this level, he had to penetrate the Garden of Eden and get Adam to willfully disobey God. Because Adam was the king of his domain. In other words, any foreign object that would come on the earth, Adam had the power and the right to eject such foreign bodies from the region because it was his domain. Can somebody praise the name of the Lord? He was ruler, he was king, and there are things that God had entrusted to him that God was not going to turn around and do it himself. Can somebody praise the name of the Lord? And that is why when the enemy penetrated the Garden of Eden and he was able to cause Adam to willfully disobey God, according to Paul, Adam was not deceived. It was Eve that was deceived, but Adam willfully disobeyed the voice of God. It was to him that God said, of every tree that is in the garden, you may freely eat of it, but this one tree of knowledge of good and evil, I don't want you to have anything. And the enemy knows that. If Satan is going to have access to your life, he can only have access when you give him permission. Let me say that one more time. If the devil have access to your life, only you can give access to the devil. If you want the devil to stop raining on your parade, you need to evict him out of your house, evict him out of your marriage, evict him out of your life, evict him out of your church, and let him know that God has made you a king in this domain. Somebody ought to give God a praise in this house. Come on, lift your hands and shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. So God's intent is that man was to rule his creation. God wanted man to rule his domain and not necessarily to rule over God's people. One of the things about the kingdom of God, it levels the ground for everybody. It doesn't matter what title you wear. And one of the things that we're trying to do, Bishop, is to change the minds of the people to stop thinking that certain powers and rights are reserved for those who wear a title and title only. But as a member of the kingdom of God, you have certain legal rights in the kingdom. Can somebody praise the name of the Lord? I believe it was Brother James said, if there be any sick in the church, what should you do? Call for the elders. But he talked about those afflicted. There's something that happened to you that you need to pray. You don't need to be calling the pastor at 2-3 o'clock in the morning. The power that resides in him or her also resides in you. And guess what? The God that we serve, he is present, help in time of trouble. You don't have to wait for him to get into his car to start the engine and to drive across town. He's living right on the inside of you. Somebody ought to give him peace in this house. Come on and shout hallelujah. He's a present help in the time of trouble. Oh, give two persons a high five and tell him he's here. He's here with you. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. The third thing is, while Jesus walked on the earth, he used miracles to announce that the kingdom of God was with them. In Luke chapter 11, verse number 20, it says, but if I cast out demons with the finger of God, watch this, surely the kingdom of God has come upon you. So when Jesus was teaching the disciples and the multitude, what stood out more than anything else was the miracles that he worked, especially when demons were subjected to his power. The disciples were always taken aback. Yes, he multiplied the five loaves and the two fishes. He caused blinded eyes to be open. He caused the deaf ear to be unstopped. And he caused the dumb to speak again. But when Jesus cast out a demon, that was something that was remarkable. You might remember when Jesus was on his way to Gadara. And the Bible said that he sent the disciples ahead of him. And while they were on their way to Gadara, a great storm came on the ocean. And the storm was very disruptive to the point where the disciples believed that they were going to lose their lives. In the midst of it, they saw Jesus walking on the water. There is something that happens in the spirit realm. The devil don't know everything. But sometimes he has a preview of what God is getting ready to do in your life. And I believe that as Jesus was on his way to Gadara, that the demons that possessed the man that lived among the tombs knew that Jesus was coming. And so they had to disturb the elements. They had to disrupt the ocean. They had to disturb the air. And why was that significant? Because the disciples, if they had perceived that there was a storm coming, they would have deferred their trip for another more convenient time. Jesus already knew that a storm was going to come. But it was not a natural storm. It was not organic. It was spirit generated. Can somebody praise the name of the Lord? Listen, troubles will come, but some trouble that come to you is not because of your brother. It's not because of your sister. It's not because of your husband. It's not because of your wife. It's not because of your church. But the enemy will create a storm to distract you from what God wants you to do. You must possess the spirit to discern that this is the enemy at work. Somebody ought to give him praise in this house. To point, as soon as Jesus got off the boat and walked on the land, guess who greeted him? Hallelujah. The man that was possessed. And the Bible said Jesus looked at him and asked him, what's your name? What's your name? What's your name? They said, we are legion. The Bible says because there are many. It is said according to the Roman calculation, it could be up to 6,000 demons. So one man possibly had 6,000 demons on the inside of him. But guess what? They recognized that when Jesus came on shore, that the kingdom of God was there. And because God's kingdom was there, they know that they could not stay. So hear what they did. They preempted Jesus. They said, Jesus, we know you're going to cast us out. Oh, but we're asking you permission to go into the swine. Stop begging the devil to get out. You need to command him to come out of her, to come out of him because of who you are and the God that you serve. Somebody ought to give him praise in this house. Hallelujah. Look at your role. Say, devil, if you're here, get out in the name of, come on, look at your role. Look at your role. There is a miracle that is in store for you in this house tonight. I don't know what God is getting ready to do, but I feel in my spirit that God is setting the atmosphere because his kingdom is about to come and his glory is about to be manifested. If you believe it, shout hallelujah. Tell the neighbor, victory is mine. Oh, Lord, I want you to prophesy to your situation. I'm not going to go into a preaching mode, but I want you to stand. I don't know what it is that you're going through your life, but I want you to take your rightful position and whatever crosses are in your life, whatever is going wrong, hallelujah, whatever is out of alignment, I want you to bring that right now to the forefront of your mind and tell it, you will no longer have dominion over me. Hallelujah. Come on, speak to yourself. Speak to your situation. Speak to what is happening in your life. Speak to that devil that is sitting on you at home. Speak to that devil that's on the job and declare who you are in God. Somebody ought to pray. Hallelujah. Somebody said, I'm a child of God. Sit down for a little bit. So we talk about where is the kingdom. The next thing we want to talk about, what is the kingdom of God? What is the kingdom of God? simply put, the kingdom of God is the rule and reign of God. And we use the word rule intentionally because when we talk about the reign of God, our culture, because we are all the way on the west side, we have no conceptualization as to what it means to have a king. And so it's difficult for us to really grasp what it means reign, but we are more familiar with the word rule, R-U-E. So when we talk about the kingdom of God, it is the rule of God. It is the rule of God. So whatever situation, whatever circumstances, God rules in that particular situation. When we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in essence, statements are redundant, because when you say thy kingdom come, in what we call the Lord's Prayer, or the prayer that was taught to the disciples by Jesus, when we say thy kingdom come, thy will be done, we're saying the same thing, because if God's kingdom come, his will is going to be done. And the reason why the Lord wants us to pray thy kingdom come, thy will be done in the earth is this: God's will is always being done in heaven perfectly. There is nothing wrong in heaven. Heaven is a perfect place. Hallelujah to God. In the earth, God's will is not always done. And the reason why his will is not always done is because mankind is out of alignment with God. Now, no matter how good the car will drive, if the front wheel, if it's a front wheel drive, or if it's a rear end drive, the rear ends are out of alignment, the drive is not going to be smooth. You're going to be moving, but not smoothly as how you would like. But when everything is in alignment, everything is functioning and are aligned up as design, then the vehicle will be able to function as it should. Now, you and I, and at any time, individually or collectively, we are outside of the will of God, it makes us disaligned with the things of God, which means the will of God will not be done in the earth as long as mankind is out of alignment with God. So when we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in the earth as it is in the heavens, what God is saying to us, that those of us who are on the earth, listen, we cannot look to the sinners to bring in God's will on the earth. We cannot expect those who don't know God to cause God's will to be done in the earth as his will is being done in heaven. The only persons, the only people on planet earth that can invoke the will of God in the earth are those who are the people of God. Let me say that one more time, because you don't believe it. By virtue of your response, you really don't believe it. The only people on earth who can cause the will of God to be done in the earth realm is the people of God. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, God said, I will hear from heaven and I will heal the land. You change political party, it will not make a difference. The only person who can make a difference is when the people of God come in alignment with the will of God, then his kingdom will come and his will be done. Somebody ought to give him praise in this house. Come on and shout hallelujah. If you don't believe it, the Bible says that a king's heart is in the hand of God. It doesn't matter who is leading. When the church begins to pray and come into alignment, God has the prime minister's heart in his hand. He can turn it in whatever direction he wants. Ask Pharaoh. He will tell you. God told Moses, go tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And then God told Moses that I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart. I want you to know that God rules in the affairs of men. You don't need a promotion from your boss. You need a promotion from God, because doors he opened, nobody can shut. And whatever he shut, nobody can open. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. Somebody give him praise in this house. Come on and bless the Lord. I want you to over the fear within the church that people are holding you back. Listen, nobody can hold you back. Amen. No pastor, no bishop can hold you back. We may put a temporary stay on you, but when God's hand is on your life and it is your time and it is your season, God will put it in the heart of leadership. Don't you know that many times as a leader, there are people that you look at and there are people that you want to put in certain positions. You want to give certain responsibilities. You don't have all the facts, you don't have all the information, but based upon what you have, you believe that brother so-and-so will be fitting for the job. And as soon as you go to do the job, you cannot do the job. Why? The reason why you cannot do the job is because God is not ready to place that person in the position that they are seeking. Are you following what I'm saying? But when time comes and when your season comes, God is going to elevate you. Can somebody pray in the name of the Lord? Tell the neighbor, wait on your time. Wait on your time. And don't be in a hurry, because when God get ready to use you, he will use you. Somebody say amen. The kingdom of God, as I said earlier, and the kingdom of God is the realm of God's actions. Amen. The realm of God's action is resurrection and is mission, according to Dallas Willard, an author. He said the kingdom of God is the realm of God's action, his resurrection and his mission. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 13 to 14, according to the classic amplified version of the Bible, it says, the Father has delivered and drawn us to himself out of the control and dominion of darkness and has transferred us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, which means the forgiveness of our sins. Let me read it one more time. Father has delivered and drawn us to himself out of the control and the dominion of darkness and has transferred us into the kingdom, the King James Version says, of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption and the forgiveness of sin. Now, what God has done, especially within the New Testament era, to make you a part of the kingdom of God is to deal with the issue of sin. It is something that you could not do on your own. God, in establishing his kingdom in the Old Testament, gave them his laws. We call it the Decalogue. If we break it down, it would be 613 commandments. The commandments were not necessarily a list of do's and don'ts, but they were instructions by which God reveals his character and his nature to those who were a part of the kingdom of God, those who were citizens in the kingdom of God. The problem with that is that the law tells you the nature of God. The law reveals the character of God, and it tells you what God requires of you. It places the demand upon the members of the kingdom, but it did not empower the individual to do what the law requires of us to do. That's why the scripture says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So every man, every person who ever opened the matrix of the womb was born a sinner, excepting for the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, all have sinned and come what? Short of the glory of God. Sometime when I look in the church and watch how we deal with each other, I perceive that we don't recognize who we are in God. Because when you try to judge another member of the kingdom by virtue of what they have done outside of the will of God and you condemn them, what you don't recognize is that you are saying, I am a better sinner than that other person. But guess what? You are still a sinner. Oh, can somebody praise the name of the Lord? In Jamaica parlance, we would say, today for me, tomorrow.
Can somebody praise the name of the Lord Jesus? So we have to be careful how we handle one another. Look at somebody, tell them, be careful how you handle me. Oh, hallelujah, because I am a member of the kingdom of God. So Paul declares, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, which means that we all fell below the standard of God. Now, let me qualify that. Because that does not mean that as a member of his kingdom, you should live your life carelessly. But you should live your life vicariously by allowing Jesus to live in your life. Paul says, the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. It is not I who live, but it is who? The Christ who lives in me. So when you are a member of the kingdom of God, it is not you who live, but it is the Christ who lives in you. And the only thing that makes you different from the people that are in the world is not because you're coming to church, is not because you were baptized in Jesus' name. Jesus is the only force that distinguishes you from the world. If you take away Jesus, you are the worst possible sinner there can be. Somebody ought to give God a praise for saving you. Come on and shout hallelujah. And so in the New Testament era, what God has done, he has taken out the work out of what was required in the Old Testament, and this time he made it by grace. So Paul says, for by grace are you saved, not of works, lest any man should boast. So when you respond to God in repentance, when you respond to God's word by being obedient and be baptized in the name of Jesus, when you stand at the altar and receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, understand this, that it is God who gave you the grace to do the above. In other words, you could not come to God except he draws you. So the fact that you are in the kingdom, it was not your choice, but his choice. Jesus said to the disciples, you didn't choose me, I chose you. When you come to church, you're not doing the church a favor. You're not doing God a favor. You must understand that you're privileged to be occupying the position that you are in the kingdom of God. The Bible says, not many wise, not many nobles, but God has chosen the base things of the earth so that he may confound the wise. Somebody ought to give him praise because he has chosen you to be a part of his kingdom. Come on and shout hallelujah. Come on and shout hallelujah. Come on and shout hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I'm glad to be a part of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. It is not my position that makes me special. It's an act of God's grace. And because God has given me grace, you can sing on the choir. Because God has given you grace, you can act as an usher in the church. Because God has given you grace, you can play the musical instrument. It's not because of your ability. And even if your ability contributed to it, it is God who gave you the ability. So at the end of the day, we have to say, to God be the glory. If it had not been for the Lord who was on my side. Oh, do I have a witness in the house? Somebody give the Lord praise in this house. Come on and shout glory to God. Praise God. Somebody shout hallelujah. If you ever want to change the atmosphere in your road, just shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. So we looked at what is the kingdom of God. We looked at what is, furthermore, we looked at where is the kingdom of God. Then we look at what is the kingdom of God. Now we're going to look at how do I live in the kingdom of God. And I'm coming close to a close. According to Dr. Rick Warren, he says, to live a kingdom life, we must love the Lord with all our heart, all our soul, and all our strength. He went on to explain, to live a kingdom life, we must love the Lord with all our heart, which he refers to as our emotions. Sometimes people wonder why are apostolic people so excited? Why we act so crazy when we come into the house of God? And for some of us, we don't wait until we come into the house of God. Sometimes we're on the job and we'd really like to shout hallelujah. We add us of the hum, glory to God, hallelujah. Because every time we think of the goodness of Jesus, it stirs something on the inside. It makes me want to cry sometimes. It makes me want to laugh sometimes. It makes me want to shout, oh, hallelujah. When you love God, you got to love him with all your heart. Tell the neighbor, put your heart into it. You can't say, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. And your mercy never failed me. Where is the joy? I love you, Lord. And your mercies never fail me. I don't know the rest. But you do so with joy. David said, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and come into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and what? Bless. So love the Lord your God with all your heart, your emotion. Then love the Lord your God with all your soul, which speaks of your volition or your will. Sometimes you have to purposefully bring yourself to worship God and to be obedient to God. Being obedient to God, beloved ones, is not automatic. You're in a spiritual battle. You have to fight. The kingdom suffereth violence. But the violent, you're not going to get your joy easy. You're not going to overcome temptation easy. You got to do it by force. I told the folks on Wednesday night that sometimes I'm afraid of my own mind because the thoughts that come to my mind, hallelujah, hallelujah. It is said you can't stop birds from flying over your head, but you can stop them from making what? Thoughts will come to you, evil thoughts, wicked thoughts. And intentionally, you have to decide in your will to thrive. Paul says, whatsoever things are lovely, true, virtuous, honest. He said, if there be any virtue, you must what? Think on these things. Thinking positively has to be intentional. Because you know Jesus and you have the Holy Ghost, don't mean your thoughts are always going to be pure. Sometimes there's some evil thoughts that will be going through your head. Even while worshiping, you will see something flash across the screen that disturb your spirit. You will see something that want to steal joy, but you got to make a decision. It doesn't mean it's not affecting you. You're making a decision. As for me and my house, I will praise the Lord. In other words, I'm going to take my heart, I'm going to take my soul, I'm going to take my mind, I'm going to take my body, and I'm going to give God the best praise. I may not feel like it. I am making a decision that I'm going to praise. That's why your emotions need your will. Because sometimes you don't feel it, but you have to will it. Tell somebody, when you don't feel it, you must will it. Now, let me say that one more time. When you don't feel it, you must will it. So if you come to church today and you don't feel well, you got to begin to think well. You cannot give in to how you feel when the feeling is not right. When the feeling is negative, you have to use your will to give direction to how you feel. So even though I'm not feeling right, I can will myself, hallelujah, until my feeling is caught up with my intellect. Oh, somebody ought to give God a praise. I may not feel like praising him right now, but I learned the more I praise him, the better I. Somebody shout hallelujah. Come on, put those hands together and give the Lord a praise. So the soul refers to your volition, your will, your mind. And he said, with all your mind, that refers to your intellect. Intellect. I was talking to a
a pastor once, and she told me that she don't need her mind. She don't need to think. I said, ma'am, there are so many people out there who would do well with a sound mind. And you have one and you don't want to use it. Do you know that's why some of our prayers are not being answered? Because we already have the answer, but we're too lazy to think. Let me let that simmer. Some people have a lazy mind. We have a godson, our grandson, or both, who was afraid to walk. He was over 1 year old and he was afraid to walk. But we know what grips him. What grips him was fear. The fear of falling. So we had to build up his mind by reassuring him that we're there. So sometimes we take him by the hand and we walk with him and then we slowly let it go. But he's so quick, by the time you move over your hand, he does grab onto you and get back to the floor. What were we doing? We were training his mind. His muscles needed to be trained as well. But your muscles training can be delayed if your thinking is negative. Because if you're thinking you cannot do it, you are right. Your muscles will respond to how you think. But if you think you can do it, your muscles will, you are right also. Because your muscles will respond to what you think. As a man thinketh in his heart. So if you don't get healing because you believe you will never be healed, you're right. And if you believe you can be healed, you're also right. The healing comes to your mind before it comes to your body. That is why Jesus said, and this is kingdom principle, every person that Jesus was getting ready to heal, even though it was obvious, the man at the pool waiting for 38 years, can't walk, it almost sounded ridiculous for Jesus to ask him, what do you want me to do? Really? And the man explained, it is not that Jesus needed an explanation. The explanation was God retraining his mind. Because he was thinking to himself, well, the angel comes once a year, once every now and again. And every time I am going, somebody step ahead of me. Now watch this. Listen to what he said. Every time I am going, somebody step ahead of me. Watch this. They stepped ahead of him because he expected it. He expected the people to pass him. So even though he wanted a miracle, he would never get it. Because in his mind, somebody is always in a position to step ahead of him. And Jesus was not asking that question, but Jesus got him to confess his faulty thinking. And when Jesus got him to confess, he now retrained his mind. He said, okay, this is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to explain to you all of that. This is what I want you to do. Just take up your bed. Just get up, take up your bed, and walk. What was the Lord doing? He was retraining his mind. Take up bed. That's an impossibility. So if he began to make a move to take up his bed, he had to think that he could. Oh Lord. So what the Lord was doing was retraining his mind. Because if he thinks it's possible, it is possible. I don't know who I'm speaking to today. But God is trying to get you to change the way you think. Because the miracle comes to your mind before it comes to your heart. Oh, come on. Somebody give God a praise in this house. Come on and shout hallelujah. Come on and shout hallelujah. And then he says, and all our strength, a physical body. Listen, it is very important for all of us, especially today's young people's day. Listen, it is very important for young people to praise God while you're young and give him your best. You know what I tell my young people? I said, if I see the older folks praising God more than you, something is wrong. You know why? Because the older you get,
You realize that when you kneel down, you don't get up that fast. You love the Lord equally, you don't love him any less. But your body is not moving with the program. Hallelujah. So while you have the strength to serve God, you must serve him with all your... Somebody shout hallelujah. Touch your neighbor and tell him, serve the Lord with all your might. We must grow in knowledge and perspective. That's knowing, conviction and character, that's being, and skill sets. We must grow in these areas. I want to look at this final section, and then Bishop Carter, sorry, if you want to come at that point, you can. I was looking at some kingdom principles that I think is very important as we talk about the structure of the kingdom. There are some basic things. I'm going to give you just four. There are more, but I'm not going to give you just four that I believe is very vital. Principles on which the kingdom of God is built. Everybody say structure. Everybody shout structure. This building is able to remain intact because the designer, the visionary, take into account the capacity of this building and all the trusses that are needed to hold up the roof and what it needs to hold up the physical structure that was in the mines. In other words, the designer had to take what he thinks in his mind and put it on paper. And then he have to think about material. So there are some material that you use on the roof that you cannot use in the cornerstones, because the cornerstones help to hold up the entire building. If the kingdom of God is going to last, and it will, it must, because Jesus said, upon this rock I will build not just my church. My church was the means to establish the kingdom here on earth in the New Testament. But he said the gates of hell will not prevail against it. But we must understand that there's a structure that holds up the kingdom. Can somebody say amen? Number one, the structure of love. Everybody say love. In John chapter 13, verse 34 to 35, it reads, a new commandment I give unto you. That's Jesus talking to the disciples. What is the new commandment? That you love one another. That's not new. Is that new? Is that new? Talk to me. Loving one another. Is that new? In the Old Testament, the command that has to do with relationship, so that we must love our neighbor as ourselves. What is new about this commandment is this. Here is the twist. He said that you love one another as I have loved you. So in other words, if you want to love one another the way Jesus commands it, you have to study how he loves us. You can't effectively love your neighbor until you know how Jesus loved. And Jesus loved to the point where he gives up his life for the believers. Are you following what I'm saying? So when Jesus said, we must love one another as I have loved you, what he was doing was shifting how we love to a higher dimension of loving. Because in the original commandment, nothing is wrong with it when he says, love thy neighbor as thyself. But implicit in that commandment is that in order for you to love me, you have to learn to love you. And in this world, some people are too much in love with themselves. And there are others who, conceited. And there are others who don't love themselves adequately. So on the spectrum of life, we have the two extremes. People who just think it's me, myself, and I. Everything is centered around you. And then you have those who always say, nobody will love me. And they walk in the church and they complain and they say, nobody in the church love me. And I've always said, if nobody in the church love you, why you don't just love you? Why are we so dependent on people to love us? That's because of relationship, yes. But really think about it. Can anybody love you like Jesus? Think about it. Who can love you like Jesus? Who can love you like how God? For God so loved the world that he gave his only. The Bible says, for a good man, some may die. Some will be willing to give up their life, even if it's tantamount to nothing. But nobody can love you like how God loves you. So love becomes the pivot. It becomes the hub on which you learn to love yourself. Now, because we are so deformed as human beings, God teaches us a new way to love. And Jesus said, love one another as I have loved you. Watch how I function among my disciples. He gave the many examples. One of the outstanding examples he gave was the woman that was caught in the very act of adultery. The Bible said the religious people brought her, laid her before Jesus just to hear what he would say. And the Bible says Jesus down, wrote on the ground, never said a word. And except that he said, whichever of you is without sin, let him cast the first stone. He stooped down again and continued to write. By the time he raised up his head, everybody left. What was Jesus demonstrating? He was demonstrating the act of love that resulted in forgiveness. Sometimes one of the struggles we have within the kingdom is that we fail to forgive others, which brings me to the second building structure, which is forgiveness. In Luke chapter 17, verse 3 to 5, it says, take heed to yourself. If your brother sins against you, what should you do? Rebuke him. Don't go spread propaganda on him. Don't go tell everybody that your brother hurt you. But you should rebuke him. And if he repents, what should you do? Kingdom principle, what should you do? Anybody? If he repents, what should you do? When somebody repents, what should you do? Let me come down. I don't think I'm hearing right. So let me come down a little bit. When somebody repents, tell it that they're sorry, what should you do? Forgive them. Forgiveness is imperative as a part of the kingdom. Because the Lord said, if you don't forgive, neither will I forgive you. So if this kingdom is going to stand, it will have to be built on the principle of love, and it has to be built on the principle of forgiveness. Guess what? As long as we live, we are going to hurt each other at times. So sometimes you have to decide to forgive even before the offense is committed against you, so that the kingdom can propel into its future. Can somebody say amen? Talk to somebody and tell him, forgive. Tell him again, forgive. I won't say the other thing that I was going to say. The Bible says, and if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day, and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent. Hear what the Lord says. You shall forgive him. Hear what the disciple says. And the apostle said unto the Lord, Lord, increase our faith. It was a faith for a miracle. It was a faith for healing of the body. It was faith to forgive. Because what the Lord just told them, if somebody in one day hurts you seven times, and seven times they turn around and tell you that they are sorry, the Lord is saying you must forgive them. That's a hard tablet to swallow. Who find that easy? Let me sit down because I don't qualify. Any hands raised? Anybody? Somebody do something? Seven times in one day? Not one time a day. No, seven times in one day they hurt you. And for the seventh time they turn around and say, I'm sorry. The Lord said you must what? You must forgive them. That's a hard tablet. So the disciples said, Lord, increase our faith. And that's what we need to pray for. When people hurt us, and sometimes they will, and sometimes the hurt is so hard, only the grace of God can help you to forgive them. But guess what? It must be done. Somebody give the Lord a praise. I know it's rough, but it's right. Number three, servant leadership. Mark 10, 35 to 45. We don't have the time to go through all of it. But this story was when the disciples, Peter, James, and John's mother, wanted one to sit on the right, one on the left. And the Lord said in verse 43, but so shall it not be among you. In other words, leadership in the kingdom should not look like leadership in the world, because they lord it over one another. But hear what the Lord said. But so shall it not be among you. But whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister. And whosoever of you will be the chiefest shall be a servant for all. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto. That word minister means to be served, but to minister or to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Many industries today, many corporations today are realizing that the best model of leadership, they don't call it that, but it is kingdom servant leadership. When those at the top are willing to come down like Jesus did and wash the disciples' feet, you are modeling servant leadership. Can somebody praise the name of the Lord? Can somebody shout hallelujah? And number four, I'll end with number four, and that is humility. Humility. Mark chapter 10, verse 13 to 16. Jesus uses the example of a child and said to the disciples that in order for us to enter into the kingdom of God, we must become like this child. And that child exhibit humility. Have you ever wondered, have you ever noticed rather, that no matter how you reprimand a child, they may be angry, they might be upset, but give them a few minutes to come running right back to mommy. That changes as they get older. But when they are in their stage of innocence, so to speak, when you reprimand them, that is why it is always good to bend the tree before it gets old. Because something that we're dealing with in teenage years, we shouldn't be dealing with those. We shouldn't have dealt with those when we're 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years old. When we start dealing with things that we should have dealt with then, it's difficult to bend the tree when they get to their teenage stage. Can somebody say amen? In James chapter 4, verse number 6 through to verse number 8, the Bible talks about humility. It says that God resisted the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Tell somebody, stay humble. Come on, look at them and say, stay humble. Matthew 6 verse 33 said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Jesus as king, he's the only king. We are subjects of his kingdom. And because we are subjects of his kingdom, God reveals to us the mysteries of his kingdom. God bless you as we give God praise and glory. Bishop Carter, I'm going to invite you, sir, to wrap up. I don't know how you want to do it. Questions, add to it, take away from it, whatever you want to do. I think dinner is 3 o'clock, so if we dismiss now, we're still going to have to wait. So we have a few minutes. Can you come, sir? Please receive Bishop Benjamin Carter as he comes at this time, in Jesus' name. I will stay nearby in case he rebukes me, reprimand me, and I have to come back and correct anything that I may have incorrectly presented. Please receive Bishop Carter.
Give the Lord praise today. What a powerful, powerful teaching. Amen. Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Hallelujah. I thought, bishops, you didn't leave anything on the bone. So, and I guess when you have nothing but the bone, maybe all they can do is make bone broth out of it. Honor and respect to shepherd of this house, to Honorable Bishop Holdsworth, and to everyone here at Greater Grace. I'm so blessed to be with you all here at Convocation 2020, and it's a blessing just to be back here on Jamaican soil again. To God be the glory. Great things has he done. And this was a powerful, powerful teaching. Give the Lord a hand praise again today. The structure of the kingdom. The only thing that resonated to me as Bishop, as you were sharing, and you touched on some things that I have shared many times about the long-standing debate on the kingdom of heaven compared to the kingdom of God. And obviously the Jews did not even want to say the name of God without it being something very, very relevant. And so that's where kingdom of heaven came in. And I remember reading about the great discourses that are in Matthew's gospel, and they're only in Matthew's gospel, five discourses. The Sermon on the Mount is the first one, and then the call of the disciples in Matthew chapter 10, and then the kingdom parables in Matthew chapter 13, and then Matthew chapter 18, where he deals with conflict in the church, and then, of course, the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24. Scholars believe that Matthew, because Matthew was talking to a Jewish audience, obviously, he was talking to the whole church, but it was specifically directed to a Jewish audience. And so Matthew's language was something that Jews would understand that others that would be in the church would not necessarily understand. That's why the genealogy starts in Matthew, identifying Jesus through the genealogy of Abraham and of David, so that the Jews would know he has a right to be the King of Kings, the King on David's throne. But they say that these five Olivet, these five great discourses tie into the five books of Moses. That Matthew 5 and 7, 5 to 7, parables, if you will, of the Sermon on the Mount, that ties in with Genesis. And that when he called the disciples in Matthew 10, that ties in with the book of Exodus, where the children of Israel were called out. When he deals with the kingdom parables, that deals with Leviticus, wherein the priesthood was established with the children of Israel. And then with Numbers, that's the conflict that deals with the children of Israel when they should have been able to go into the promised land, but they didn't. That's where the wandering stood it, and that's Matthew 18 tied in with Numbers. And then Matthew chapter 24, Deuteronomy, where the Lord gives the law the second time. So there's that kingdom parable that picks up the books of the law with Matthew's gospel. But Matthew 13, I think, is so powerful because Jesus says the kingdom is likened unto. Translation said, he said, it's like this. And if I could just add maybe a little topping to what Bishop shared, we're in a fight, saints of God. We're in a battle, and we're going to be fighting until the end comes. No matter how we like to slice it, we're in a battle. This must be why Paul said, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God that you will be able to stand. We're in a fight. But I took a look, somebody said, into the back of the book, and we win. Revelation chapter 11 says, the kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdoms of the Lord and his Christ, and he shall reign and rule forever. But if I could say something, in the meantime, there's going to be a fight. And I believe that's what Matthew 13 is saying. Some scholars say that there are seven of the kingdom parables. Pastor Maxwell, I really believe that there are eight. I believe Matthew 13:52, where it says the kingdom is like a householder.
It doesn't necessarily say that that is one of the kingdom parables, but I believe that's the capstone. He said, he starts out with the parable of the sower. Bishop Holdsworth, I think there are eight, and the first four are negative, and the last four are positive. Look at the first one, the parable of the sower. Four different types of ground, but only one ground is fruitful. Out of all of the planting, it seems like you're only getting production out of one piece of ground. Seems like the enemy is stealing the seed. But Jesus said the kingdom, he was speaking to his disciples, the kingdom is going to be like this. You're going to seem as though you're fighting an uphill battle. You're going to seem as though the enemy is winning. But that's going to be part of the kingdom. So that's the first negative. The second negative is, if one part of the ground is productive, the wheat and the tares picks up the fact that that productive piece, an enemy went in at night and sowed in tares that looked like the wheat to confuse and corrupt the harvest. But that's what the kingdom is going to be like. Don't lose hope. Then he says the kingdom is like a mustard seed that grows into a great tree. I know many scholars say that's the spread of the gospel. I tend to believe it is the spread of religion and Christendom. Are you hearing me? Church has become, and when I say church, Christendom, religion has become big business. It is growing exponentially. Once upon a time, preachers were poor. Once upon a time, when Peter and John met the man at the temple and they said, silver and gold have I not, but such that I have, give unto thee. I didn't have any silver or gold, but I got the power. We're living in a world now where the preachers got the silver and the gold. Not the real preachers, but you know what I'm talking about. We're living in a world now where religion is big business. The Catholic Church owns more property on the face of the globe than any nation or entity on earth. The Catholic Church. And the Mormon Church is right behind it. Religion is big business. I believe that's the mustard seed. That's the mustard seed that's growing. But look what was in that mustard seed tree. The fowls of the air built a nest there. Well, isn't it the fowl of the air that was stealing the seed that fell first? That says something about the structure of the end times. So that's the third of the negatives. The fourth, the kingdom shall be like yeast or leaven, hid. That's the operative. Hid in the three measures of wheat. Bread is the source of life. Jesus said, I am that bread that came down from heaven. But here is bread that has leaven, hid. That's doctrine that is corrupted. And it's in the bread, which is the source of our life. So that's the four negatives. But then look at the positives. I believe Jesus was saying, you're going to seem as though the enemy is after you at every time, and everything you do, it seems like he is getting the upper hand. After all, he is the prince of the power of the air. In the military, they always taught us the first way to occupy an enemy is to control the airwaves. Are the airwaves controlled? Every bit of information you hear is coming from the sky. The satellites, the internet, and the adversary is polluting it. So that was the first four. But look at the last four. The kingdom shall be likened to a treasure hid in a field. A lot of debate has been about that, Pastor Maxwell. You know what the treasure I believe is? The treasure is Israel, the people of God that he called out of nothing and became his people. Now they are hard-headed, they have been rebellious, they have been stiff-necked, but all the precepts were given to them. All of the patterns of the structures of the kingdom was given to Israel. But they are buried in the earth. When I did my dissertation some years ago, I did a preface of Israel. On the nations of the earth, the U.S. has almost as many Jews as the nation of Israel. And they make up one half of 1% of the 8 billion people that are on the face of this earth. Has anyone heard of the Nobel Peace Prize? The Nobel Peace Prize has been given for about the past 200 years based on Alfred Nobel, who was the producer or the inventor of nitroglycerin and dynamite. And he was the one that brought that explosive onto the scene. Obviously, it has turned into a weapon of great destruction. That was not what he wanted it to be. But he has a peace prize named in his honor. And that peace prize goes to the best of the best in science, in medicine, in literature, and all of the most disciplined areas in humanity. In the past 200 years, there have been over almost 1,000 Nobel Peace Prizes given out to nationalities all over the globe. You know how many Jews have gotten that prize? Almost 300. A little group of people that represent less than one half of 1% of the entire world population. Over the past 200 years, they have won almost a third of those prizes, establishing that they are the brightest, they have the most wisdom, and they are the smallest of people. Why is that? That's because they are the people of God. Irrespective of their unbelief of who God is. Are you following what I'm saying? They are the ones that he covenanted with. So I believe the treasure in the earth is understanding the history of God dealing with his people. Paul said to the Romans, whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning. What were the things that were written aforetime? The things that the Lord spoke to Israel. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. So the first negative is, when we understand who God is and how he has dealt with his people, we can know he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's long-suffering to us, Lord, just as he was long-suffering to Israel. Yes, he punished them for a while, but he said, my anger was just for a moment. So that's the first of the positives, that he has invested in his people, Israel. The second is a pearl of great price. Everyone knows a pearl is the only jewel that's alive. Gold is just a shiny yellow rock worth a lot of money, but it's just dirt that's together, and it's just a yellow rock. A ruby is just a red rock. An emerald is just a green rock. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? But a pearl is living. And you know how a pearl comes? A pearl is made when the oyster gets sand or some intrusiveness that gets inside of its membrane, and the oyster begins to try to salve and get rid of that irritation. And as it keeps applying internal solvent around that irritation, it keeps growing and growing and growing. And after a while, you have a pearl of great price. That's the church, because we came from irritation. We came from all of the persecutions. And what did it do? It cost Jesus his life. He purchased the church. The pearl of great price came from the shed blood of Jesus Christ. So that's letting us know now the kingdom is like the treasure. It's like the pearl. But then it's like a net that's cast into the sea and brings in all manner of fish, good and bad, but they're all caught into the net. The Lord is letting his people know, I have a kingdom that's able to reach. When it says cast into the sea, the understanding of sea is that is the people. It's cast into the oceans of life. And he's going to gather them all in. Aren't you glad to know that? And then he finalizes with, in a great house, a householder has treasures. Old, that's Old Testament. And new, that's New Testament. And when we know that we've got this fight going on, and the Lord has equipped us to endure it, then we're going to mount up as the soldiers that he called us to be. And we're going to endure hardness as good soldiers of Jesus Christ, taking upon us the whole armor of God, that we will be able to stand in the evil day. Are we in the evil day, saints of God? I heard Bishop say another, the kingdom suffered violence. And let me tell you, that was spoken 2,000 years ago. How violent is it getting today? And we haven't begun to taste what's coming. We haven't suffered blood like some are suffering now. But take unto you the whole armor of God, but that you may be able to stand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, have your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, having your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, having on the helmet of salvation, have the sword of the Spirit and the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, but also have prayer. Praying with all prayer and supplication for all saints. We're in a fight, saints of God. But be encouraged. In the meantime, Christ in you is the hope of glory. I hope that just kind of capped what we were sharing, Bishop.
Come on, put your hands together again for Bishop. Bishop Carter expounds the word so well, and we are looking forward for a treat on Monday. We have a few minutes, just a few minutes. We want to open this session for any questions that you may have. So we're going to have you at this point if you have a question. I don't know if we can be provided with a mic or two. We're going to give you a chance to ask a question pertaining to the structure of the kingdom. I see a license plate here. You see it? That could be my vehicle. I don't know. I know it's a Honda CRV, is it?
That's it? Say, it's not mine? Oh, okay. Oh, good. Good, good, good. So, do we have any questions? Well, what question do you have? You can stand up. Yes, go ahead. Can we get a mic to kind of, I don't know if you're streaming it. We have mics down here. Brothers, any you have any mics over there can provide for? Yes, just. All right, good. Thank you so very much. Oh. So you can help her on this side. You work this side. She work that side. So let her work that side. So she needs a mic. Yes. Just hold your hand up if you need a mic and she'll come. Yes. All right, go ahead. The question. All right. All right, can you, is it on? All right. Keep talking in it. Let's see if it comes up.
Two.
That's it. That's it.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So you spoke about the structure of the kingdom, and you mentioned the fivefold ministry. I wanted to know, because there are many conversations about whether or not there are still apostles. So would you say that the apostle function or that position is still functioning now? That's my question.
Thank you. Very good question. It's an ongoing debate, and on both sides of the fence, there are those who are, it's not that they want to be anti-apostles, but we have many persons who have abused the office of who an apostle is and what the function is, and that of a prophet. And so you find one side of the spectrum that fights against the teaching. So what they're fighting against is not necessarily the functioning of the apostle. They're fighting against the abuse of the position, where there are people who have made themselves apostles. I've heard of apostles who never pastor a church, who never do any such thing. Now, if we're to get back to the scripture in Acts chapter 1, because Judas had lost his place, it was necessary for somebody to take his bishopric, according to the book of Psalm. So they put out the criteria, and some of the criteria include they have to have been with Jesus from the beginning, or they have to have seen Jesus. And of all the persons, there were only two men that were qualified. And so they cast that lot, and the lot fell upon Mattathias. And even though we have never heard anything else about him, he was the apostle that was chosen at that particular meeting. Paul described himself as an apostle born out of due time. Interestingly, when you read some of the Pauline epistles, there were other apostles outside of the 12, meaning that even Barnabas was referred to as an apostle because of the functioning of these individuals within the church. And their primary responsibility was to, number one, to establish churches. Paul, as an apostle, functioned as a missionary. He never pastored any of the churches, though he probably started most of them, but he never stayed to pastor any of those churches. But he saw himself as a father within the apostolic realm, and as a individual who was given the mandate to set the foundation. So the Bible says in Ephesians that we're building, I think it's Ephesians 2, that we're building on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. So if there are modern apostles, and I believe there are, they are not foundation layers, because the foundation is already established by the early apostles. But they do serve the responsibility of maintaining apostolic order within the kingdom of God. And there's a level of authority and anointing that God has placed upon these men to function not in the local assembly, but in the church on a global level. So persons who may have this office are not just church men within our, or somebody who does have a little thing on Facebook or YouTube and call themselves apostle. This person is called to function within the body of Christ.
And so when they are recognized, wherever they are functioning, we can always bring them into the church. So to respond to your question quite directly, I believe because of the need of the church to be perfected and to be formed into the image of Christ, that that apostolic anointing and ministry is still necessary for today. But not as how we are seeing it around us. All right? And let me give an example. We're not exalting anybody. But really and truly, if you look at, and I'm not saying this to expand anybody's head or mind, or to think differently of a person, but if you look at the anointing that sits on men like Bishop Holdsworth, if you look at anointing that sits on men like, for those of you who may know Pastor S. Robert Stewart, these men are not just bishops. These men carry an apostle's anointing that wherever they go, they can impact the body. There are some people who can preach a message, but somebody who carries that heavy anointing will stand and speak, and they command attention. They command attention, and that a level of anointing, I believe, is resident in all. We may not call them apostles, and I'm not saying we should, but we should look at the function that the Holy Ghost is doing through him. Amen? Praise God. Hope that satisfies. Next person. I know I saw somebody getting over here. And any other question? Yes, go ahead. There's somebody at the back.
Bless the Lord.
God bless you.
I want to find out whether or not the kingdom is here now, or is it coming, or is it existing simultaneously? The reason why I ask, there's some indication when Jesus spoke that the kingdom is at hand. And then there are other indications. Well, when he spoke, he said that it is at hand. And then there are other indications that says, when I cast out demons, the kingdom of God is come upon you. So there are indications that it is to come. And then it would appear that it's also already here. Is it that these two realities exist simultaneously? That's my question.
Very good question, Sister Demeter. I saw when you were coming in to church, so I know you missed that part of the presentation. So you are correct on all levels. Jesus did say the kingdom of God is not with observation. He say, lo is here or lo is there. In that particular context, because he was teaching the disciples that the kingdom of God is not necessarily over there or over that side, but the kingdom of God is within you. In the Gospels, when the scripture says the kingdom of God, when Jesus commissioned the disciples to go out and you must tell them that the kingdom of God is at hand, the correct Hebrew translation is that the kingdom of God is here. It is in the here and now. To confirm that, when he sent out the disciples and they went out two by two, they came back rejoicing. What were they saying? They said, Jesus, the deaf hear, the blind see, the dead were brought back to life, because the kingdom, the miracles, the signs and the wonders that accompanied the preaching of the word was evidence that the kingdom of God was present. Amen? So it is always here. It's always in the here and now. However, there is also a futuristic aspect of the kingdom. Because as it is today, not Jesus, we know him as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But that is not happening in actual reality yet. That's our confession. We know that is true. But the time is going to come. And the scripture that was reiterated by Bishop Carter in Revelation chapter number 13 talks about the time when the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdom of the Lord and his Christ. So there's a future aspect of the kingdom wherein all the kingdoms of the world is what we call the millennial kingdom, when Jesus Christ will establish his kingdom permanently on the earth by rebuilding the throne
of David. When David desired to build God a house, God flipped it. God said, you desire to build me a house, but instead, I'm going to build you a house. And he said, there'll be no ending to your kingdom. So when Matthew gave the genealogy to Abraham and mentioned David, all Jews realized that the Messiah will and must come through the Davidic line, because it must be a son of David, which Christ was, that will sit upon that throne forever. So that is still future. Yes, he did come over 2,000 years ago, but he's coming back. And when he come back the next time, he's going to come and he's going to reign as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Can somebody shout hallelujah? What a day that will be. Hope that helped. Thank you. Beautiful questions. Any other question? Just raise your hand so we can see. All right. So it's either I did a great job or I did a terrible job. You have been a very good audience. Teaching is challenging, especially when the teacher is up just before you eat. There are two dangerous parts. When you're hungry, to listen to a preacher. And the second one is after you're full, to listen to a preacher. But you have done well. Put your hands together. I'm pleased to welcome our bishop, none other than Bishop Dr. C.A. Oldsworth, in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, put your hand together and bless the Lord, everybody. Just stand to your feet and bless the Lord, everybody. Could you stand to your feet, shake somebody's hand, hallelujah, and say kingdom greetings, kingdom greetings. Come on, open your mouth, kingdom greetings. One of the things we must do in church is open our mouth. Hello? This is not the place for silence. This is the place to open your mouth. Come on and give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah. Victory is here when you open your mouth. Hallelujah. So we're going to curse that dumb spirit in Jesus' name. Open him out and just shout hallelujah, somebody, everybody. Yes. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. What a wonderful session. Amen. Wonderful session. Wonderful teaching by Bishop Wayne Williams, assisted by Bishop Benjamin Carter. Put your hand together and bless the Lord for them today. Come on, you can do better than that for the men of God. Hallelujah. I knew that these men are capable of doing a great job in expounding the kingdom. You cannot explain the kingdom in its entirety. It would take us eternity to explain the kingdom of God. And of course, it's the Demeter's question is very, very important and relevant, which was answered by Bishop Wayne. Praise God. Amen. Because there is a present and future aspect of the kingdom of God. Amen. And the outcome is going to be very good. As Bishop Carter mentioned in Revelation, the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdom of our God and his Christ. In other words, all the rulers of this world and all the powers, United States, Britain, France, China, Russia, shall become the kingdom of our God and his Christ. And here's the beauty about that. Because, amen, this is speaking about the earthly reign now of the Lord in this kingdom. I like the scriptures, and then you shall reign with him. Come on and give God a praise. Oh, lift up your hands and give God a praise. Touch someone, say, you shall reign with him. So in other words, God has for the future earthly jurisdiction for every one of you in this room. Come on and give God praise. So now you have to begin that rule by being rulers right now. Come on. Tell somebody, practice to rule. Come on, tell somebody, practice to rule. Oh, you're not talking to somebody beside you. Come on, tell them, practice to rule. In other words, the more you become a ruler here, the more assignment God gives to you. And the brother says last night,
Amen. Bishop, pastor, said the preacher, finish your assignment. Each assignment you finish in the kingdom, God has another one for you. Hello? In the kingdom, the reward for work well done is more work. Jesus demonstrated that when he mentioned the talent. Gave 1 10, 1 5, 1 2. Amen. And one got one. Remember that story? The man who got 10 got what? 10 more. 5 got 5 more. And they were given more. They were given 5 more. And then they were given more. The one that got 2 got 2 more. The one that got 1 buried his talent. Accused his master of being an austere man. Hello? And he took it from him and gave it to the one who had 10. Oh my God. Come on and give God praise. Oh, come on and praise the name of God. Hallelujah. So therefore, there is, amen, reward for work well done. And God has some promotion in this house for somebody. You didn't hear that. God has some promotion in this house for somebody. Come on, look at somebody and say, you're up. Come on, look at somebody. Don't look at me. Look at somebody beside you now, man. You're up for promotion. Come on. You're up for promotion. Your name came up. Hallelujah. And is that bishop put up your name?
Yes, sir.
It's Jesus himself.
Right.
Hallelujah. Come on and bless the name of the Lord. Nobody can stop this. There's no nepotism in God's promotion. Hallelujah. You are up for promotion. Is it wonderful? Come on and bless the Lord, everybody. Come on and bless the Lord. Come on and bless the Lord in this house. Thank you very much, bishops, for, amen, this lovely day. Amen. And this is the first full day. I think we had a beautiful day. Our young people did a wonderful job. Amen. Dramatizing the kingdom, speaking about the kingdom. Amen. And we know that those of us who are senior, that this work, amen, is being transitioned into capable hands to do the work of the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Amen. It's time for dinner. Are you hungry? Let me see all the people that are hungry. All right. And you have a right to be because you have been here since 10 o'clock this morning. Amen. Tonight is going to be a great night. Tonight is going to be a great night. And these benches are going to be filled. And you know your duty. Those of us who are from Greater Grace, we're going to yield to the guests tonight so that our people that are coming will be seated. Amen. And then, of course, we know what to do. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. But it's going to be a great night. Our preacher again is Pastor Dr. Janiri Ennis. He did a great job last night and is going to be doing tonight again. And I want to remind you of tomorrow. Tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. will be our annual prayer breakfast. And this time it will be in Portmore. I hear the facility is looking so good. I'm dying to be there tomorrow, and the breakfast is going to be sumptuous and nice, so we're going to enjoy that in the name of the Lord. Those of you who have not gotten your tickets yet, remember to get your tickets. Amen. $5,000 for ticket, I think. Is it 5,000 or 4? Is it 4? I think it's 4. Right. All right, so bear in mind 4, and that's reasonable for a breakfast these days. Amen. I go sit down at some place for a breakfast. It's costing me $6,000 just to sit down and eat a regular breakfast. Amen. So we're thanking God for all of this. It's offering time. Tell somebody it's offering time. Offering time. Come on. It's offering time. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. So we're going to stand to our feet right now and bless the offering. Everybody, please stand. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you. Thank you for the gift that we're about to give to your house, to this cause today. Thank you, Lord, for making us who you want us to be so we're able, Lord God, to give, for providing for us. Lord, we pray you bless this offering. Oh, Lord God, amen. For you say that those who give generously, it shall return, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men sow into us. Amen, into us. Lord, we thank you right now. Bless us now, we pray. Amen. And bless the offering in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise the name of God. Hallelujah. We're going to march from the back. Amen. And come on up and give the offering. Start with our right. Amen. At this side. And then, yes, on my right. So those on my right, you to please stand. Everybody on my right. Amen. From the back. And you're going to march up and give the offering in Jesus' name. Amen. Please, everybody. Those are sitting in the back, please stand, everyone. Please be obedient, beloved. Be obedient to the word. Be obedient to those who are in command. Amen. Amen. Please come on up now. Amen. In Jesus' name. The kingdom of God is within me. The kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Oh, the kingdom of God is within me. The kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Oh, the kingdom of God is within me. The kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Oh, the kingdom of God is within me. The kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Oh, the kingdom of God is within me. Oh, the kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the king. Please stand, everybody. Oh, the kingdom of God is within me. The kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the king. Overseer Stennett, will you come and close us in prayer? The kingdom of God is within me. Overseer Stennett, the kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Oh, the kingdom of God is within me. The kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Oh, the king. Pastor Stennett, will you come and close us in prayer? The kingdom of God in coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Oh, the kingdom of God is within me. Please stand, everyone, as we close in prayer. Coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom. It is power. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Praise him. Stand to your feet, everyone, as we close in prayer. All right, you might not have known the song, but it's an old-time song. The kingdom of God is within me. the kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Can we do that one more time? The kingdom of God is within me. The kingdom of God is coming forth. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. It is power and authority, love in reality. This is the kingdom of God. Praise the Lord. Pastor Stennett.
Let us pray. Holy Father, we thank you today for gathering us together and for your word that has been ministered to our hearts. Our hearts have been touched. The seeds have been sown. And Lord God, we know it will bring forth the fruit that meet to the glory and honor of your name. We thank you, Lord, for this fellowship. We thank you for the ministers that you have used so ably and wonderfully today. We bless and honor you for this day, for this moment in time, for it will register in the future that it was a good day, a day that was ordained by you to lift us to a higher place. Continue, Lord, to let your word be digested in our hearts, that our intellect might be transformed, that our minds might be changed, and that, Lord God, in the years to come, we can look back on this time and say it was good that I was in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Continue to work upon us, God, and as the rest of the time of this convocation is before us, we pray that you'd bless every moment and let it be precious, working your purpose in our lives, your people. We thank you today and we continue to glorify you. Remember tonight's service. Let your awesome presence rest with us in a mighty way. Move in a mighty way, God. Let your Shekinah glory sit upon us. And that, Lord Jesus, everything will be done to the glory and honor of your name. Remember the meals today that will be shared. I pray that you'd bless it to our bodies and our bodies to your glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Now, dinner will be served. A little while, you're dismissed. There'll be no benediction until tonight because we continue. So we say the benediction tonight. God bless you. You're dismissed. Thank you.